Good afternoon. My name is Corina Stratan and I work at Topdesk. It's a company where we make service management software. I'm a developer, but recently I've also been working in some project where we had some infrastructure configuration to do. And today I'd like to share a couple of things that I learned about configuration management. I'll start with what is configuration management and what kind of problem it's trying to solve. Then I'll go through a couple of things that you should think about when you choose a tool for configuration management. And in the end, we'll see a couple of examples of tools. So what is configuration management? It's basically about setting up the infrastructure where you're going to run your applications or your Docker containers or your Kubernetes clusters. And infrastructure can be physical machines or virtual machines or even network routers. And configuration in this case is things like having the right software packages installed on those machines, having the operating system configured properly, having the user accounts that you need to run your applications, and so on. Back in the days, this used to be the job of the system administrator. You would have a system administrator that would be in charge of a couple of servers, and they would either configure them manually, or in the better case, they would write some scripts to automate the process. Now things have changed. We're not talking about a couple of machines anymore. We have tens or even hundreds of machines to run an application. And sometimes you also want to add or remove machines dynamically to your setup. Also, it's not only system administrators and operations people that do this kind of stuff. Sometimes we developers also need to be able to deploy our code into production ourselves. Now, manual configuration is definitely not an option anymore. And shell scripting can help, but if you do plain scripting, that these are usually quite low-level languages. They're difficult to write, they're difficult to maintain, and they're not going to get you very productive. So this is where configuration management tools like Puppet or Chef or Ansible come into place. These tools can provide you the possibility to distribute configurations to a large number of machines very quickly. And also they provide you with higher level languages where you can define your configurations more easily than writing a script. Where do these tools fit in the bigger picture? Probably you heard about the concept infrastructure as code. What it means, it's basically an approach to managing infrastructure in the same way that we manage software applications. So by having infrastructure configured in code in the first place instead of manually, by having this code into version control and by having automated tests on it and so on. And there are two main steps in the whole process of infrastructure management. One is provisioning, that typically refers to getting a set of machines that you need for your application, like getting them from your infrastructure provider. And the other one is configuration management, which means once these machines are up and running, set them up with everything that you need to run your application. And the tools that we have today for provisioning and for configuration management basically enable us to do infrastructure as code. So now to go back to configuration management, let's see a couple of things to think about if we have a project to do and we want to choose a tool. First thing is the language. Just like in programming, for configuration management, you also have imperative languages or declarative languages. While imperative languages are focused more on the how, like the steps that you need to take in order to achieve a result, while declarative languages are focused more on the what, like what is the result that I'm trying to achieve. Let's see a short example how this might actually look like. For instance, if we choose an imperative language, this is an example from Chef that uses an imperative language. Let's say you want a software package installed. Then you would write a code that looks kind of like this. I have a package and I want to do an action with it. I want to install it. If you use a declarative language, this is an example from Ansible that uses a declarative language, you would say something along the line, well, I have a package and I want the state of that package to be installed. Infrastructure people tend to prefer declarative languages because they are more high level. And when you use such a language, it allows you to reason more easily about when you see a piece of code, what is the now the state of the infrastructure after this code was run. Also, the tools that use declarative languages, they do quite a lot of work in the background for you to achieve the state that you say you want to achieve. So when you install a package, they will check, is that package already installed? If not, do I need to install it? Do I need to put it on the later version and so forth? And that is great because it means that you have to write less code because the tool will do a lot of stuff for you. But on the other hand, if you have some special case where you want to do things a bit differently, then you might have some limitations with a declarative language. Another thing to consider is what kind of architecture you want. Actually, most of the tools have a kind of master-slave architecture where you have a number of nodes that you want to configure, and you have some master machine that will store the configuration and will distribute them to the nodes. And there are two ways to do this distribution. You can some tools do it in the push way, as in master. The master will send the configuration to the slaves. The other approach is the pull-based, which means that the nodes will ask themselves the master for configurations or for updates. Another thing, some tools require you to install some kind of software agent on the machines that you want to configure. You especially want to do that if you want to use a pull-based, if you have a pull-based system. The advantage of having agents in there is that you have more control on your system, and especially for large production systems where you want to make sure that your nodes are always synchronized and up to date with the configuration, that is a good use case for having an agent. On the other hand, if you just have a small system, like maybe some small internal infrastructure where this is not so important, the agent might be too much overhead and also too much trouble to install. Also, another use case for agentless systems is if you really want to do just a one-time configuration. For instance, if you want to generate a virtual machine image or a Docker container image, you can also do that with configuration management tools. And then you can just use a simple agentless tool that just does a one-time job, basically. Now, let's see a couple of examples of tools. One of the oldest tools around is Puppet. It's an agent-based tool, which means that it does take quite some effort to set up. It has a declarative language. They made their own domain-specific language for this, which does mean that it's relatively easy to write your configurations. And Puppet is very often like the tool of choice for a lot of operations people and system administrators. Another tool is Chef. It's also agent-based like Puppet, but it has an imperative language. And this sometimes is more attractive for programmers, especially if you like Ruby, because Chef uses Ruby as a language. Chef is typically seen as more difficult to learn and to configure, but it does offer you more flexibility, like if you want to do things really your own way. And the last tool that I'm going to talk about is Ansible. This is a newer tool, and one of the design goals for this tool, according to the makers, is that it is radically simple. And it is really significantly easier to get started with it than with the other two, because it's agentless. So all you need to do in order to run Ansible is be able to run Ansible code somewhere on some machine and then be able to connect with SSH to the machines that you want to configure. For this reason, we also chose Ansible ourselves for the smaller projects that we do in development in our company. But our cloud infrastructure that is managed by operations, they use Puppet. For language, Ansible uses a declarative language, actually YAML. And just to give you a feeling about like how this looks like, I will show a little code example. This is some Ansible code that installs the Samba file sharing system on a Linux machine. Specifically, this is an example from our own code where we set up where we configure a CentOS base machine. And what we have here is they are called tasks in Ansible. We have a couple of tasks. The first one is a task named YAM. This YAM is like the software package manager in CentOS. And here it's quite straightforward. We say to YAM we want to install the package Samba with the latest version. The next step that we need to somehow set up the configuration file for Samba. One common way to do that is we have a file on the master machine and we copy it to the node that we want to configure. So this is what we also have in this example. So it's a task named copy that takes a file and copies it. What you see here is just copying the file as it is, but Ansible also provides you the possibility to put dynamic things into the file. It provides a templating system for that. And the last part, we also need to make sure that Samba is like enabled as a service on the machine and is started at boot every time. And for this, we have a task called systemd. That's the like service management system in CentOS. And we specify that we want this service to be started. Now that was it actually, and to wrap it up, if you want to start using a tool for configuration management, you have a couple of things to consider. Do you really want continuous updates on your nodes, or do you have more like a one-time task setup? Also, do you have a large project or a small project? The thing is that, for Ansible, it uses SSH communication, which tends to become inefficient if you really have a lot of machines. So then it's better to consider an agent-based system. Of course, do you have a preference for a specific language? Once you consider all these things, it's always good to also try the tools yourself and see what you like the most. That was it. Thank you. If you have questions, I think just come here in the break. I'll be around.